With trusting in Jesus and welcoming his healing presence in our lives, let us please stand and join the choir in the opening hymn, City of God, found on page 12.
Mercy. bring us life everlasting.
reading from the book of wisdom. God did not make death, nor does he rejoice in the destruction of the living. For he fashioned all things that they might have been, and the creatures of the world are also. And there is not a destructive job among them, nor any domain of the nether world on earth, for justice is undying. For God formed man to be imperishable. The image of his own nature he made him. But by the envy of the devil, death entered the world. And they who belong to this company experienced it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a large crowd gathered around him, and he stayed close to the sea. One of the synagogue officials named Jairus came forward. Seeing him, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with Jesus, saying, "My daughter is at the point of death. Please, come lay your hands on her, that she may get well and live." Jesus went off with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed upon him. There was a woman afflicted with hemorrhages for 12 years. She had suffered greatly at the hands of many doctors and had spent all that she had. Yet she was not helped, but only grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. She said, "If I but touch his clothes, I shall be cured." Immediately her flow of blood dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of her affliction. Jesus, aware at once the power had gone out from him, turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who has touched my clothes?" But his disciples said to Jesus, "You see how the crowd is pressing upon you, and yet you ask, 'Who touched me?'" And Jesus looked around to see who had done it. The woman, realizing what had happened to her, approached in fear and trembling. She fell down before Jesus and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has saved you. Go in peace and be cured of your affliction." While he was still speaking, people from the synagogue official's house arrived and said, "Your daughter has died. Why trouble the teacher any longer?" Disregarding the message that was recorded, Jesus said to the synagogue official, "Do not be afraid. Just have faith." He did not allow anyone to accompany him inside except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they arrived at the house of the synagogue official, he caught sight of a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. So Jesus went in and said to them, "Why this commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but asleep." And they ridiculed him. Then he put them out. He took along the child's father and mother and those who were with him and entered the room where the child was. He took the child by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." The girl, a child of 12, arose immediately and walked around. At that, they were utterly astounded. Jesus gave strict orders that no one should know this and said that she should be given something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you. So I see we have a number of children here, and I'm curious how old they are. And so if you have a child that is 1 year old, raise your hand. A 1 year old, okay, good. 1 year old, three, 2 years old. No 2 year olds, okay, we don't have any terrible twos here. We're okay. Three. Okay, 3 year old, 4, 5, Children can now start raising their hands. If they're 5 years old, raise your hand. Six. Okay. Seven. Who's 7 years old? You're seven. All right. Eight. 8 year old. Nine. 10. Good. 11. Good. 12. Any 12 year olds? No. 13. Anyone between teenagers? All teenagers. Okay. Good. So in the Jewish tradition, after you were 12, you became an adult. Okay? You were considered grown up. Okay? And so in the gospel today, we have this woman who had been sick for 12 years. And because of her sickness, she was considered impure. She couldn't go to church. Now we've been struggling because of the pandemic, and we haven't been able to go to church for 1 year. Imagine 12 years of not being able to go to church. She was desperate, and she went to all the doctors, and not one of them helped her. Instead, they took all her money, and she got worse. So the doctors weren't helpful. So she's desperate, and she says, I have nobody else to turn to. But I heard of this Jesus character. Let me go to him and see what happens. So that's one story that we have going on. Another story that we have going on is Jairus. And he was a synagogue official. He coordinated everything in the church. And his daughter was sick. And she was 12 years old. Just short of being considered an adult. And so this is a tragic, sad story. The man's daughter is home and she's dying. And so, because he was associated with the church, he was a little skeptical about Jesus. Okay? He wasn't supposed to be a believer in Jesus. In fact, he suspected, his friend said, don't go to Jesus, it will be embarrassing. If you, a synagogue official, seem to be going to Jesus, that's not going to look good for us. But he was desperate. And so even though he may have had differences of thinking or was skeptical, okay, and his friends told him not to do it, he says, I have to try. I love my daughter so much, and I have to try. So in both cases we see, it's not that these people were necessarily following Jesus every day and with Jesus all the time. Jesus didn't owe them any favors, okay? In fact, they may have been a little bit distant from Jesus. But something had happened in their lives where they're like, I'm going to try. I'm going to reach out to Jesus, and I'm going to see what happens. And Jesus sees their faith. He sees the sincerity of their desire. And how does Jesus respond? Daughter, okay, with tenderness, with gentleness, he says, daughter, you're healed. Don't worry about it anymore. And then he goes to the little girl, and he tells her, daughter, arise. It's with great tenderness and gentleness. So in the first reading, we hear, God creates us to have life, and to have life in the fullest. And God does not want anything to take away that life that he gives us. And so, the good news is, we are created in God's image. Each of you are created by God, loved by God, and when God looks at you, God says, wow, wow. Now, that spirit, there's an evil spirit sometimes at work in the world that makes you think, maybe I'm not good smart enough. Maybe I'm not pretty enough. Maybe I'm not whatever enough. And in God's eyes, you are more than enough. So, can you find yourselves in need of something? It doesn't matter whether you've been praying a rosary every day, okay, or going to church all of the time. When you need something, reach out to Jesus. Reach out to touch him. And let him turn to you with that same compassion that he has in the gospel today. The compassion that says, my son, my daughter, you are created in the Father's image. I can't help but love you. It's like that stray dog that follows me around. Okay? I try everything I can not to pay any attention to him. Okay? But he comes and he rubs up against me and follows me everywhere. He won me over. Now I love him. Okay? Be that way with Jesus. Turn to Jesus in your need. Don't be shy. Know that Jesus' response is going to be loving. Know that he will heal you of whatever you need to be healed of and strengthen you to share that loving kindness with one another. Amen? So now let us
come to you knowing that we are your beloved children, that you care for us and desire to respond to our needs. Help us to continue to reach out and trust in your goodness. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation. sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Again, we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing.
together with Francis, our Pope, Lawrence, our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and the entire people you have made your own. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters, and inspire in us words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Help us to serve them truly after the example of Christ and at his command. May your church stand as a living witness to truth and freedom, peace and justice, that all people may be raised up to a new hope. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection, give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and martyrs and all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. For it is through him, and with him, and in him, O God, the mighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, to live and reign forever and ever.
Amen."
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's share with one another a socially distant sign of peace.
Thank you.
divine sacrifice we have offered and received, fill us with life, O Lord, we pray, so that now to you in lasting charity we may bear fruit that lasts forever. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Announcements this week. If you haven't